like to make a call. Please hang up and try again.
Erin Robinson assaulted Raul Ortiz on August 11, 2014, outside his Tampa, Florida home. The incident was incited by apparent inappropriate sexual remarks by Ortiz to Robinson's girlfriend. Ortiz had no brain activity following the incident and never regained consciousness. He died 4 days later. Robinson has been charged with the beating death of Raul Ortiz.
Spell your last name for us.
My name is Kimberly Boyette and my last name is B-O-Y-E-T-T-E.
Do you recognize that?
Yeah, that's Adina. And this is 12th Street. And I live over there beside the open field, like you said.
Okay, and for the record, where you're pointing to is on the opposite side of 12th from Adina, there's a big open field, and you live just north of that open field.
Yes.
You can't really see your house from this aerial map, is that fair to say?
No, because you got the trees and stuff.
Okay, so is here where these trees are, is this roughly where your house would be?
Yes.
Now, just across the street from you, catty corner, there's another structure over here. Do you know what that is?
That's Raul.
And who's Raul?
Hello. A friend. Okay. That lived across the street.
Do you know Raul's last name?
Ortiz.
Raul Ortiz.
Yeah.
Okay. Is okay, this
when you're talking about over here, for the purposes of the record, you're gonna need to say north, south, east, west, or right, left, top, bottom, or something like that in order to identify where on the map visually you're talking about.
You were right ahead of me, Joe, that's where I was going. So for the record, we're talking about here on the map, if 12th Street is running north and south, so it would be the southwest corner of Adina and 12th, there's a structure here. This is the home of Raul Ortiz?
Yes.
Now, how do you know Raul Ortiz?
When my grandmother bought the house, they lived across the street. We grew up around them.
And how long have you lived at that home there at 309 12th Street?
308
12th 308,
Street.
Sorry.
It's been, I was like, made a young one. Exactly, I don't know age, I was a teenager.
Okay, I don't ever want to ask a lady her age, but can you give me a rough idea in years?
Well, I'm 53 now, so it was like maybe when I was 12 and 14 years. Right,
so roughly 40 years you lived there?
Yeah.
Have you known Mr. Ortiz to be your neighbor across the street there for the entire time?
Yes.
Did you become friends with him?
We talked and later on we became friends.
Okay, and sometimes people are friends like we're just neighbors, we say hi to each other, and sometimes people are more social, they hang out, they
He used to come over and give the kids snacks and stuff.
So he was a friend of your family?
Yeah.
Not just your neighbor?
No.
Okay. This is State's Exhibit 3 and 3A specifically. Can you see that okay?
Yes.
And what are we looking at here?
That's Raul's house.
All right, and here's State's 3B.
That's just one of his gates.
All right, and is this the gate that goes in and out of Mr. Ortiz's property? There is a mailbox here.
Yeah.
It's got the numbers 309. Is that the address of Mr. Ortiz's residence?
Yes.
And this mailbox and the gate, are they facing basically 12th Street?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Here's State's 3C. 3D, the gate basically opens, I think we see here, to a sidewalk, is that correct?
Yes.
And in the background, you can see railing.
Yes.
And it looks like the front door.
Yes.
Is that the porch you're talking about?
Yes.
This would be the porch, I mean the sidewalk of Mr. Ortiz's home. This is States 3E and F.
Yes.
And then here in States 3G, does he have a tree here by the front gate?
Yes.
And to back up so the jury knows for point of reference.
I know that you kind of are anticipating his where his question's going, but you're starting to answer before he's quite done with his question, and so we can't really get that recording when that happens, so wait until he's completely done with his question before you answer yes or no for me.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay?
Yes.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks.
And here in States 3G, we can see this plant has like some white flowers on it. And then again, is this in States 3E, is this the same plant here with the white flowers?
Yes.
Okay, so that tree's by the gate there. That's the way Mr. Ortiz's property would have looked around the time of August 11, 2014, is that correct?
Yes.
what do you notice happens with the people in these two pickup trucks?
They get out.
Okay, and let's talk about them. There's two pickup trucks. Are they the same color or different colors?
Different colors.
So for ease of the jury's keeping track of which pickup truck is which, tell me the color of one of the trucks.
White.
And tell me the color of the other truck.
It was maroon with camouflage.
Camouflage.
At the bottom.
Okay. So there's a white truck and a red truck for ease of description. Is that fair?
Maroon.
Maroon, okay. A white truck and a maroon truck. As the white truck comes up 12, well, which truck is first?
The white.
The white truck. As the white truck comes up 12th Street, tell me what it does specifically. And if you need the map again, I'll put it back up.
It stops right, like, right when you pull onto Edina.
So it makes the turn onto Edina and stops very short on Edina?
May I get up?
Yes, ma'am.
He stops right about here.
Okay, so now he's kind of on the north side of Mr. Ortiz's property there on along Edina.
Yeah.
And what does the red or maroon truck do?
He pull in behind, but then moves to the right on 12th Street.
Okay, well you said it pulls in first. It pulls in where first?
The white one pulls in first.
Okay.
And then the maroon.
Pulls in on Edina behind it?
Yeah. But then it moved to the front.
It moved to the front of where?
Of 12th Street on this side.
All right, so it pulls into Edina temporarily, but then eventually goes back onto 12th,
yes.
Kind of in front of your home?
Yes.
Okay. Did you recognize any of the people that got out of those trucks?
Yes.
Can you tell me who you recognized?
Erin Robinson and James Robinson.
Okay.
I'm sorry?
Erin Robinson. And James Robinson.
And how do you know Erin Robinson and James Robinson?
2 years prior to that, we had a picnic, and my friend introduced me to him.
And what friend introduced you?
Danielle.
Okay, you're gonna have to speak a little louder for me.
Get real close to the microphone if you need to, okay? So, who introduced you to James and Erin?
My friend, Danielle.
All right, so 2 years earlier, Danielle had introduced you to James and Erin.
At a picnic.
Okay, and so you recognize two of the three men that are getting out of these trucks as James and Erin.
Yeah.
As Erin gets out of the truck, along with James and the other boy, the other man, tell me what Erin is doing. How's he acting? What's he saying? Those sorts of things.
He was acting mad, took his shirt off. And acting real mad.
Okay. So angry. He's mad and he's taking his shirt off.
Yeah.
Based on what he's saying, can you tell who or what he's mad about?
Wanting to argue with Raul.
Okay.
Yelling things at Raul.
And what sort of things, if anything, do you remember him yelling at Raul?
I only remember saying, motherfucking son of a bitch, and taking his shirt off.
As he's saying those curse words, does he seem to be saying them in the direction of Raul?
Yes.
When you say Raul starts walking towards them, is there any point at which Raul gets to Erin and the boys outside the fence, or does everything happen inside?
Inside.
The fence?
Inside.
So everything that you're talking about is now happening inside this fenced-in area?
Yes.
Okay. And as Raul and Erin come together, tell me what you see.
I see him go down.
Who goes down?
Raul.
Can you tell what happens to knock Raul down?
They were fighting.
Who was fighting?
Erin Robinson.
Okay.
And next thing I knew, he was on the ground.
Okay, but you say they were fighting. Who was Erin fighting with?
Raul.
Now, when you say they were fighting, could you tell if they were throwing punches at each other or only one was throwing punches? What could you tell?
All I seen was punches, but I didn't see, no.
Who was throwing punches?
Erin Robinson.
Okay, could you see Raul throw any punches back?
I didn't see him get a punch in.
All right.
Bent over.
So he's bent over, and describe the motion that you see Mr. Robinson doing as he's bent over on top of Mr. Ortiz.
Throwing punches.
So can you see his arm going back and forth?
Yes.
Can you see it do that multiple times?
Yes.
As you're watching this, what's going through your head?
I needed to get help.
Okay, and so what do?
I yell for my sister. Well, I asked my husband to go get my sister, but he couldn't move fast enough. So I went back in, and she was already in the living room, so I yelled for her to come out, and they came out.
Okay, and so I'm going to go back here. State's Exhibit 6A. When we last left, you were standing at the mailbox. Now you talk about you go back inside. Where are you going?
The back of that, where that, you see that car in the side?
Here?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're going back inside your fence line, back towards your home. During the time that you move away from the mailbox and go back to the home to call for help, is it fair to say you can't keep your eye on what's happening in the yard?
Right. I just left for a few minutes. No, I didn't see why I was gone because I was getting help from Raul.
Now, when you say you left for a few minutes, were you keeping track of how much time it actually was?
No.
Do you know if it was 30 seconds or 60 seconds or 2 minutes or three minutes?
It could have been like 2 seconds, 3 seconds.
So you don't think it was very long?
No.
Now, you turn back to the home, and who are you yelling at in your home?
My sister and my brother-in-law.
Okay, and are they getting on the phone to call for help?
Yeah, they called 911.
Okay, Erin says, you didn't see me. Does he say anything else?
He said, I know where you live.
I know where you live. So he looks at you, he's looking directly at you, is that right?
Yes.
And he says, you didn't see me, I know where you live.
Yes.
How did that make you feel?
Scared.
Deputy Don Hess, H-E-S-S, Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office, 12 years.
Now, you can see that there's a fenced-in area of the property, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And there is a walkway, a gate, through the fence.
Yes, ma'am.
And you found Mr. Ortiz close to this gate?
He was actually inside that gate, yes, ma'am.
Right, so he was just inside the fenced-in area?
Yes, ma'am.
And to the left of that gate, there is a flower bed?
Yes, ma'am.
I am now showing you what has been admitted into evidence, State's Exhibit 3C. And so his head was to the near the left flower bed, correct?
Yes, ma'am, I believe so.
And his feet were to the right?
I believe so, yes, ma'am.
And so his body was across the paved path?
It was, if I remember correctly, it was at an angle, not specifically completely perfectly left or right of it.
Okay. So it was at an angle?
Yes, ma'am.
And you were the first law enforcement officer to arrive at the scene?
Yes, ma'am.
There were neighbors present?
One more time, I couldn't hear you.
There were neighbors present?
Yes, ma'am.
But none of those neighbors were attempting to help Mr. Ortiz?
No, ma'am.
And you didn't speak to those neighbors?
No, ma'am. One of the neighbors flagged me down and pointed to me to where I believe they were probably the person who called in the initial call, but I have no idea who that is at this point. And all their involvement was to flag me down and point, and then I saw what I saw.
And you didn't speak to them. You rushed to Mr. Ortiz?
Yes, ma'am.
And Mr. Ortiz was breathing when you still located him?
Shallow breath, but yes, ma'am, he was breathing.
And you attempted to render first aid to Mr. Ortiz?
Yes, ma'am.
But you didn't get very far in rendering that aid?
Correct.
And that was because Hillsborough County Fire Rescue arrived fairly quickly?
Yes, ma'am.
5 minutes?
Probably within, yes, ma'am. I'd say that's probably fair.
You arrive, 5 minutes later, fire rescue's there. They take over?
Yes, ma'am.
And Mr. Ortiz was then taken from the scene?
Yes, ma'am.
And you followed fire rescue?
Yes, ma'am.
So at that point, you left the scene?
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Lavinia Danielle Reynolds, LEVINIADANIELLERYNOLDS.
Thank you, Judge. Ms. Reynolds, do you go by your middle name, Danielle?
Yes, ma'am.
I want to bring you back to August 11th of 2014.
Yes, ma'am.
So at that time, you would have known, according to your years, Erin and Kayla for about 3 years?
Yes, ma'am.
And do you remember running into Erin that day?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you remember where you ran into him at?
Circle K.
Okay.
Do you even stop?
All right, I'm going to rewind back just for the record. This would be approximately... seconds or so.
I'm sorry?
It would be 34 seconds on the video, just for the record to be clear. Who did you recognize?
Kayla Bryant, Erin Robinson.
Okay. I'm going to continue to play. And if you want to go ahead and just watch the video and then we'll talk about it. I'm going to go ahead and pause this just for record at 27 seconds. Ms. Reynolds, do you recognize anything in this pause clip?
The red truck.
And whose truck is that?
Kayla Bryant.
And did you later see Kayla and Erin in this truck?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, Ms. Reynolds, I'm going to go ahead and stop it right here at 2:05. Can you describe to the jury what's going on right now?
Right now, Erin Robinson and Kayla Bryant walked to the truck. And he was pretty much angry and just, you know, saying, like, the next time you see Raul, tell him I'm going to F him up.
Okay, so I want to go back real quick. Who is Raul?
Raul is, he was my boyfriend.
And do you know his last name?
Ortiz. Okay.
And what happened after this interaction with you, Erin, and Kayla?
I pulled out and I was going to go left toward Raul's house. But then I seen them pull out behind me, so I went, you know, I got back to the right and went straight to the dollar store where I started to go before.
Now I'm pausing the second clip at 1:32. Is that you coming into the store?
Yes, ma'am.
And that's you on the phone with Raul?
Yes, ma'am.
Now at 1:43, what do we see here?
I see Erin and Robinson walking out in front of me with the phone up to his ear.
On the phone with Raul?
Yes, ma'am.
Let me continue to play. Now, Mr. Reynolds, I'm going to pause it here at 2:06. We can kind of see Mr. Robinson coming in and out of frame a little bit further back. About how far are you from him? Are you standing next to him?
No, ma'am.
About approximate distance?
Maybe 6 feet, 7 feet.
So are you able to see him very clearly?
Yes.
Are you able to hear him?
No.
When you're looking at him, what is he doing?
His body language was like... angry, hostile.
And is that just what you're observing?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear him yelling or anything like that?
No, ma'am.
After Mr. Robinson hands your phone back, what do you go do?
I continue my shopping.
And when you finish your shopping, do you see Mr. Robinson again?
Yes, ma'am.
Where do you see him?
In the parking lot of the Dollar General.
Do you see him with anybody else?
There was a white Dodge parked behind my Dodge. It was his brother James Robinson driving. Fluffy, and there was a third person, but I could only see the head. I couldn't see the body.
And how long have you known who you called Fluffy?
Not very long. He's in and out. It was a friend of theirs, so he was like in and out.
And when you came back out of the store, what did that group do?
They were talking amongst themselves, and I, you know, like, put everything out, like, I couldn't hear anything, and then the only thing, you know, my mother said, you know, that I wasn't going to be involved, you know, and then from there on, that we parted ways.
And you didn't see them again after that day?
No, ma'am.
My name is Lesha Krastowski. It's spelled L-E-S-Z-E-K-C-H-R-O-S-T-O-W-S-K-I.
I know you because I know, have known you for a while. You do have an accent. I don't know if you know that you do that or not.
Oh, yes, I'm acutely aware of it.
I'm just going to ask you because of that and because of your facial covering, if you would just speak slowly and higher than normal or at a higher volume, just so that the jurors extend out into the gallery in this particular case, and we don't usually do that, so just remember that they are out there too, so they need to hear you as well, if you don't mind. All right?
Will do, Your Honor.
Thank you.
May I inquire, Judge? Can you please tell me where you're employed?
I'm Associate Medical Examiner at the Hillsborough County Medical Examiner's Department.
And what are your duties as an Associate Medical Examiner?
Investigate death in the area of Hillsborough County or District 13 in accordance with Florida Statute Chapter 40611. That means determining cause and manner of death.
Do you specialize in any particular field of medicine?
Yes, I'm board certified in pathology and forensic pathology.
And what is forensic pathology?
Well, this is the subspecialty of pathology which deals with the whatever is used for legal reasons from the field. And forensic pathologist is basically a person who is specifically trained to diagnose diseases and injuries and to determine what is the cause and manner of death.
So you've received training to determine the cause and manner of death?
Yes.
Specific training. And what's the difference between cause of death and a manner of death?
Well, cause of death is defined as injury or disease that initiates chain of events ending in someone's death. And manner of death is just a classification, a statistical classification into one to five categories to say how the cause of death came about. It's the choice is natural, meaning due to natural cause exclusively, accident due to unforeseeable event, suicide is killing self with intention to kill self, homicide is death from hands of other person, and undetermined is when we just don't have enough information to assign it to another category. It's used for statistics.
Okay. And I believe you've already explained it, so you're saying in a medical perspective, homicide means dying at the hands of another person?
Correct. With exception of motor vehicle accidents,
okay,
which are always called accident, unless of course somebody uses a vehicle as a weapon. So in this particular case, it takes intention into account.
Approximately how many autopsies do you yourself do per year?
About 300. I don't know the current statistics. I hope they're lower. But in my first 10 years of employment in Hillsborough County, I did 305. I know precise number every year. I mean, it's average, 305 a year. And before that, it varied. 300 to 400, it depends on place and workload.
Okay.
I would estimate that I did about 6,000-7,000 autopsies in my career.
All right, doctor, I'd like to turn your attention to August 15th of 2014. Did you get assigned to a case involving a deceased individual by the name of Raul Ortiz?
Yes, ma'am.
And can you kind of explain to the jury how a case gets assigned to you?
It's random. If I am on the schedule, that the doctor who is in the morgue on a given day. I just come to work and I look at the list of cases, and this is how I get assigned to the case. Sometimes I know beforehand, before I even show up at work, because the technicians have to process the body, and they, for certain things, they have to ask my permission, like undress, wash the body, or something like this. It all depends on the case.
Okay. And randomly is how you got Mr. Ortiz assigned to you?
I think so.
Okay. When did you perform the autopsy on Mr. Ortiz?
On the same day. That was 15th, right? Excuse me. And the autopsy was performed on 15 August 2014, with external examination starting at approximately 1300 hours, which is 1 p.m., and followed by internal examination at 1:20 p.m. Well, if it's a hospital, you can safely assume that the person was washed in a hospital. Maybe not just once, but multiple times. Areas can be sterilized and so forth. So the original trace evidence that might be on the body is not there any longer. And moreover, some new trace evidence might be introduced. And I don't know what it might be. A hair fell from a nurse's head, for example. And then if we collect this, we will find nothing of interest for the investigators. So it just changes the circumstances, and it has to be taken into account.
And do you recall how Mr. Ortiz came to you? Was he a hospital transfer?
Yes.
Okay. Can you please explain to the jury what you see, what we're looking at here?
This is a view of the decedent's face from the left side, and what you can observe on this picture are lacerations on the forehead and the eyebrow. You see a contusion or bruise on the left cheek. You see hemorrhages in the orbital region. There is some blood in the nose, but then you see scabbing in the mouth as well, and contusion that extends on the left side of the face laterally to the mouth. Now the laceration in the forehead is surgically sutured, blue sutures there in the skin.
And 14B. When you talk about those surgical sutures, I just want to point to it right here. It would be on the right side of the eyebrow. Is that what you're talking about, the surgical sutures?
Yes, ma'am. The blue thread is the surgical suture. So it was treated in a hospital. And you can clearly see that both orbital region has, orbital regions have bruises or contusions. There is also a smaller laceration on the left side of the nose. So yes, these are all blunt impact injuries.
And doctor, you keep using the phrase contusion and laceration. Is there a difference between the two?
Of course.
Can you explain to the jury what those are? Can you please explain to the jury what they are?
There are three types of blunt impact injuries. And these are contusions, abrasions, and lacerations. A contusion is also known as bruise. It's just blood extravasated into the surroundings of tissue. In order to have a bruise, one has to have a heartbeat. So in other words, in a dead person, you cannot cause it. Well, you can make theoretically a simulation with beating area with lividity, but it's normally you cannot injure a dead person, so you won't see a bruise. Now, abrasion is scraping of the outside layer of the epidermis. There's usually some movement involved parallel to the skin surface. The epidermis does not have any blood vessels, so in order to cause a hemorrhage, you would have to dig into it and get to papillary dermis underneath, which is full of capillaries, and then you have hemorrhage. A typical example that most people are familiar with would be a fall while running on your knees on the concrete, and then you have the scrapings. These are abrasions. Now, laceration is the most severe of the three, and this is when the object impacts the skin, resulting in breaking its continuity. So you have a more severe impact, and the injury that you want to differentiate it with would be cut. If you take a blade and you cut through the skin, you cut through everything, so it will be a complete division. Whereas in laceration, it is based on stretching of the skin in the point of pressure. And obviously, all these tissues in the skin have this different elasticity, so smaller vessels will stretch and still hold, little nerves, big collagen bundles, and when you pry the laceration open, you will see tiny tissue bridges between the two sides, and that indicates that you're dealing with a laceration and not cut. But so this is a blunt impact trauma, and all these injuries that you saw here were blunt impact injuries, resulting from impact of blunt object as opposed to sharp. And actually, you had examples of all of them, including contusion, abrasion, and laceration.
And doctor, when you say blunt impact, can you explain to the jury what you mean by that?
I just mean that it's not sharp.
Okay.
Impact is just impact, and in most instances, I cannot even tell whether object impacted the skin or skin impacted the object. It can be both ways. In some cases, I can observe patterned injuries, and then I might say, I might be even quite exact in select cases. Like, for example, if I have hammer blows to the head, I can not only say, you know, that it was a hammer blow, I can even say how big the hammer was. I can measure it literally on the depressed fracture in the skull, how big the hammerhead is. Now, that's not a case in here. Here, I cannot opine about the shape or nature of the object that impacted the skin.
All right.
Because there's no pattern.
Doctor, I'm showing you 17A. What does this show for you?
It's a hand.
And is there anything of significance on the hand?
Not really. There's a bandage on the wrist indicating that there was an IV line.
Okay. And 17B?
This is palmar surface of the hand.
17C?
That's dorsal surface of the left hand. There's no injuries there.
And 17D?
And this is the palmar aspect of the left hand. Also, no injuries.
And doctor, why do you keep saying there's no injuries? Is that significant to you somehow?
To me?
Yeah. Well, in your examination.
I just state that there is no injuries. That's the only significance for me. I mean, in any case that it's a possible homicide, it's routine. We always do it in suicides too. front and back of both hands. And the reason is it might have some value for the investigators from police. So that's what why we do it. It's not necessary for determination of the cause and manner of death. This is even if you have injuries in the hand, they would have to be of quite significant nature to be a cause of that, as you might imagine.
Mr. Ortiz's brain and the head injuries. Did you note any sort of injury to the victim's head?
Yes.
Can you please tell the jury what you saw?
Well, apart from the superficial, external injuries that were described, meaning the contusion, lacerations, abrasions on the face, there were internal injuries, and that included fractures in the nasal skeleton. The nose was moving, and you see, nasal bones are the small bones in the very top of your nose, and the rest is cartilage. So these were completely loose and moving. And then there was no fractures here in the forehead bone, but in orbital plates, you have orbital plates going like this inside, for example, inside the skull, above the eyes. And in between, there is an ethmoid bone, which is directly above the nose. An ethmoid bone is porous. There is a lot of nerves going through it. And in the center, there is a bony structure sticking upwards like this. It's attachment of dura that goes between hemispheres of brain. Now, this.
All right, hang on a minute.
Several times you've been saying like this, and you've been showing the jurors, which is fine. But the record does not reflect what this means. So if you're showing something like this that means perpendicular, you need to say perpendicular. Or if something is located like this, and you're talking about your eyebrows, you need to say like above your eyebrows. So you have to describe with words what you're showing the jurors. All right?
I try, Your Honor. I'm sorry.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Okay, I have to rewind. From which point I start?
You can just start where you left off, but keep that in mind in the future.
Okay. So, the horizontal bones that are above the eyes are called orbital plates. Now, in between them, there is ethmoid bone. On top of ethmoid bone, there are olfactory nerves, the sniffing nerves, and they put tiny nerves down to the nose, in the top of the nose, so you have multiple holes in the bone, and this is called ethmoid bone. In the center of the ethmoid bone, upwards, vertically, sticks a plate of bone, which we call crista galli. It's Latin for rooster's crest. And the name is derived because it sticks upwards, like rooster's crest. It is an attachment of the portion of dura mater, tough matter, thick membranous structure that covers the whole brain and is attached to the skull inside. It has a part that goes from front to back vertically between the hemispheres of the brain, and in the front it is attached to crista galli. Better? Now, this whole ethmoid region between the orbital plates in this particular person was fractured and knocked out to the inside. So, if you look at my face from the side, it indicates the impact that goes by the nose bridge and upwards, like this, inwards, upwards and in. That would fracture the nasal bone and push all the structure substantially in to have the center of the bone over there inside knocked in together with the crystal galley. It can be caused by impact or it can be caused by whiplash. Now this person had injuries in the face that indicate pretty strong force sufficient to fracture and dislocate bones inside the skull. All right, so that usually is associated with some rapid movements of the neck. And I would, if you would ask about my opinion, what caused the contusions?
Outside the scope of the question, narrative.
Sustained, ask another question.
That's fine, good. Doctor, based on your review of the autopsy findings, the medical examination, together with the information that you learned, did you come to an expert opinion regarding the cause of death to Mr. Ortiz?
Yes, ma'am, I did.
And what was it?
This person died due to blunt impacts to head with fractures of skull and contusions of cervical spinal cord. And the manner was homicide.
Richard M. Blair, R-I-C-H-A-R-D, B-L-A-I-R.
Thank you, sir. If you would, please tell the jury where you work.
I work for the Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office.
How long have you been with the Hillsborough County Sheriff's
Office? 20, almost 22 years.
And what is your current assignment with the Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office?
I'm a detective assigned to the homicide section.
How long have you been a detective in the homicide section?
6 years.
You're saying you're asking Mr. Robinson. When you found Mr. Robinson, did you grab a hold of him, throw handcuffs on him, and slap him in the back of your car?
No, I was requesting him to go because at that point, I didn't have any charges on him. I just wanted to interview him.
Okay, so you had not arrested him or detained him. You were just asking to talk with him.
Correct.
Did he agree to go talk with you?
He did.
As part of Mr. Robinson agreeing to go talk with you, did anybody else agree to go with you?
Kayla Bryant agreed to go with, as well as I believe her mother. Actually, she didn't go with us. She took a vehicle and followed us to the office.
Okay, and I'm glad that we mentioned a vehicle. Do you remember what that vehicle looked like?
It was a Ford F-150 red.
What was the last one?
Red.
All right, Detective, I'm going to show you what's already been admitted as State's Exhibit number 20. Specifically, here's State's Exhibit 20A. Is this the vehicle that you're referring to that Kayla Bryant's mother drove to follow you when Mr. Robinson and Ms. Bryant went down to the station to talk with you?
Yes, it is.
Is this how Mr. Robinson appeared when you made contact with him somewhere in the late hours of August 11th going into the early morning hours of August 12th?
Yes. Now, this photograph was taken in a holding area, not in the interview room.
Okay, but it's still basically in at the
same office, same district office.
Here states 22B.
Yes.
Here states 22C. Is this the way that Mr. Robinson appeared?
Yes.
Now, sometimes photos are not the greatest. Sometimes the light plays tricks on our eyes, but you were there, live and in person. Did you see a scratch, a scrape, a bruise, cut, anything on Mr. Robinson's face that would have indicated that he might have been attacked, punched, kicked, struck anywhere in the face?
No.
We only have the one side view. But at least as far as this side, did you see anything at his jawline, his mouth, anything on his cheek that might have suggested any sort of discoloration, that there was any sort of impact or strike to his face?
There was nothing that stood out.
Here states exhibit 21D, like Delta. Is this the way Mr. Robinson's hands looked?
Yes, it is.
Here on what would be the right hand, pinky, I believe, did you observe those, it looks like scabs maybe, or dark marks on his hand?
Yes.
I understand these rights. And no one has threatened, coerced, or promised me anything in order to induce me to make a statement. I presently wish to make a statement and or answer questions without an attorney being present. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Okay. If you agree to that, in other words, that last one was saying, it's a known as threatening or whatnot to write anything down there.
Correct. We're not pushing you to do anything.
Okay.
If you will initial, you're right there in the initial box, and then at the bottom you'll see a line that says subject. If you will sign next to the, or on that line that says subject.
He's in his house, I went to confront him. When I went to confront him, he came out of his house, pulled off his shirt, yelling at me. So I was standing in front of his gate. He opened his gate, so I took a step back. And we started arguing a few choice words. And he swung. When he swung, he connected me right here inside the door. And when he did that, I swung back and I hit him 3 times. That is what I remember.
Okay. All right. Well, let's go back. So if that's where we remember to, then we'll start from where you remember from. So, Kayla said that he had been too close. Did you know Raul, or do you know who Raul is?
Yes, I know who Raul is.
How do you know Raul?
Through my dad's phone number.
Okay, is this Danielle maybe?
Yeah.
Okay.
Danielle Reynolds.
In listening to Kayla said that it was Danielle. So.
Yes, sir.
So you know Raul through your dad's girlfriend?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there, how does she know Raul, do you know?
Danielle?
Yes.
Oh, I have no clue.
No idea? Okay.
The initial strike and confrontation in the statement that Mr. Robinson gives you, that occurs outside of the fence line on public property, right?
Well, the first time he told it, he was very clear about he opened the fence and came out. And then I believe it's on the recording, the second time he goes through it, he's not as clear of where it happens, just the fence opens and then he's inside talking to him. And then he starts hitting him.
My name is James Robinson. It's spelled J-A-M-E-S-R-O-B-I-N-S-O-N.
You know Erin Robinson?
Yes, ma'am.
How do you know him?
He's my brother.
Okay. And I don't normally do this, but since you're Mr. Robinson and he's Mr. Robinson, I'm going to refer to him as just Erin.
Okay.
Okay. I want to ask you back about on August 11th of 2014. Do you recall that day?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Where were you living at that time? What area of town?
Waimama.
Okay. And was Erin living in that area of town as well?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Did you get a phone call from your brother Erin at some point that afternoon?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you know about what time that might have been?
It's a little later in the day, if I'm not mistaken.
And what were you doing at that time?
Can't really remember exactly what I was doing, but I just know I was at home.
Were you with anyone, or were you by yourself?
I was with our buddy Fluffy.
Okay. And I'll refer to him as Fluffy too, so we don't get confused on who's who. When you get that phone call from Erin Robinson, does that cause you to go somewhere?
Yes, ma'am.
Where do you go?
Dollar General.
Tell me about the car that you're driving at that time.
It was a white Dodge 1500.
And did Fluffy go with you?
Yes, ma'am.
So you didn't go out of your way to go pick up Fluffy or anything like that?
No, ma'am. He was already with me.
Why did you go to the Dollar General?
To go talk to my brother.
When you got to the Dollar General, did you speak with Erin?
Yes, ma'am.
Did he explain to you something about a situation with Raul Ortiz?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you all stick around at the Dollar General for a little while?
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Why? Why are you hanging out at the Dollar General?
Just talking to him, calming him down, getting him, just calm.
Okay. And you say calming him down, so that leads me to believe that Erin was either upset or angry.
He was irritated.
And was there anybody else up at the Dollar General with you, other than Fluffy?
No, it was just Fluffy and I.
Okay.
That went up there.
Was there anyone else there at the store?
Kayla and Danielle was there. We're trying to figure everything out, and then we wanted to go and talk to Raul.
Why?
To get down to the bottom of the altercation.
Did you know where Raul lived at the time?
No, ma'am.
Okay. How did you figure that out?
Danielle gave us, I'm not going to necessarily say directions, but gave us location, I guess. what's the word?
She told you how you can find
yes,
the house?
Yes, yeah.
So she knew that you were headed over there?
Yes.
And did you drive your truck?
Yes, ma'am.
Who was in your truck when you drove it to Raul Ortiz's home?
Erin and Fluffy.
And was Erin in the cab of the truck or in the bed?
In the bed.
Is that unusual?
No, ma'am.
Do you remember if Erin was wearing a shirt at that time?
No, ma'am, he wasn't.
He, you know what, that's a poor question on my part. Was Erin wearing a shirt at that time?
No, ma'am, he was not.
Now, when you get and find out where Raul lives and you get to the Ortiz residence, tell me what you do.
I parked on the sidewalk, on the side of the road in the sidewalk.
Now, is it your understanding that you are all headed to Raul's house for some sort of a fist fight?
Not at the time, no, ma'am.
So your understanding is that you're just going so Erin can talk to Raul?
Yes, ma'am.
Why do you need to be there?
I was just there to make sure that nothing would correspond and go too far out of the way.
Were you able to tell at that time that Erin was upset?
A little.
Was it your understanding that Raul was upset as well?
Yeah, Raul was very upset.
And so I've got on my hand Defense Exhibit 4A through F as in Frank. Have you had a chance to look at these photographs?
Yes, ma'am.
And do these photographs accurately show the area where you parked your vehicle when you went to Raul Ortiz's home?
Yes, ma'am.
And how do you know that your car was parked in the area in these photographs?
From the tire marks.
Your Honor, at this time I would move into evidence Defense Exhibit 4A through F as in Frank.
No objection. Frank,
thank you. And I'm going to show you again, you'll see the pictures on the back of the screen, 4A. And we see some tire marks on the street there. Were those tire marks left by your car?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And that mailbox that we see sort of at the far end of the photograph, is that Raul Ortiz's mailbox?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that would have been sort of right near the area where the front opening of the gate was?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So by show of the tire marks then, it looks to me, and tell me if I'm wrong, that your car would have been parked just right beyond that mailbox?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so you get to Raul Ortiz's home. What happens?
Well, when we got there, my brother got out, yelled for Raul, and when he got out and yelled for Raul, the front door was open, so Raul came out. And when he came out, he was already pretty upset. He was yelling in Spanish, and he took his shirt off, threw it on the chair, and came out.
I'm gonna stop you right there, okay? Because we don't wanna say too much at one time. Where was your brother Erin when Raul came out of the house, took his shirt off, and threw it on the chair?
Standing outside of the gate.
What did Erin do when he saw Raul do that?
He just continued to try and talk.
Fair to say that both Erin and Raul were doing a good fair share of yelling back and forth?
Yes, ma'am.
Cursing at one another?
Yes, ma'am.
Does there come a point in time where Raul Ortiz comes charging towards the front gate?
Yes, ma'am.
Where is Erin Robinson standing when that happens?
The same spot, right by the front gate.
Showing you, see, it's 3A. I'm gonna zoom in just a minute. Now in this photograph, the gate is obviously open. Was the gate open at the time that you were there?
Not when we first showed up, no, ma'am.
Okay. At some point, does the gate become open?
Yes, ma'am.
How does that happen?
Raul opens the gate.
What happens once Raul opens the gate?
When Raul opens the gate, he swings and punches my brother.
Does he actually make contact?
Yes, ma'am.
Where does he make contact?
In the face.
Do you remember right or left side?
I don't remember that. to be honest.
How does Erin respond to that?
He punches him back.
And where is Erin when he throws that first punch that he throws?
He is still on the outside of the fence.
Where are you standing at that point?
At that point in time, I had just gotten out of the truck.
Is there anything obstructing your view or kind of in between you, keeping you from being unable to see what's going on?
No, ma'am.
What happens after that Erin throws that punch?
After that, he threw a few more punches, and that was it.
About how long does this entire fist fight last between the two?
The whole thing couldn't have been no more than 25, 30 seconds.
Less than a minute?
Yes, ma'am, less than a minute.
How does it ultimately end?
It ultimately ended, my brother had hit him the last two times and we had left.
Where is Raul Ortiz when the whole incident is over?
Laying on the inside of his gate.
And how does he end up there?
He had fell backwards into his gate.
Ms. Dunker pointed you to the excusable homicide instruction, and I want to go back to it because she characterized the state's argument as we're hanging our hat solely on the cruel and unusual manner. And that's not correct. Before you ever get to cruel and unusual manner, you've got to get past accident and misfortune, and you've got to get past sudden combat. It is not an accident. It is not a misfortune when you know you have a temper problem. It is not an accident and a misfortune when you know you cannot regulate your temper problem and you have to call your brother to come do it for you. It is not an accident and misfortune when you ignore the advice of your fiance who tells you to drop it and you choose to press forward. It is not an accident and a misfortune when you announce to Danielle Reynolds that when you see Raul, you're going to beat his ass. And it's not an accident and a misfortune when you tell your brother when he gets to the Dollar General that you want to fight. And it's not an accident and a misfortune when you get in a car and you drive across town to somebody else's house to confront them in their own home. It's not an accident and a misfortune. It's a choice. It's a really dumb choice, but it's a choice. And it's also not a sudden combat. You can't be itching for a fight. You can't be announcing an intention to have a fight. You can't drive yourself to the place where the fight's gonna happen and then say, oh, sudden combat. Erin Robinson knew it was coming. Erin Robinson decided that that's what he wanted. And every action he took was to that end. It's not just that it's cruel and unusual, because it is. It certainly is cruel. But it's also not sudden combat, and it's also not an accident or misfortune.
State of Florida versus Erin B. Robinson, case number 14CF11818A. We, the jury, as to count one of the indictment, find as follows. The defendant is guilty of first-degree felony murder as charged. We, the jury, as to count two of the indictment, find as follows. The defendant is guilty of burglary as charged. During the commission of the crime, did Erin Robinson commit a battery against Raul Ortiz? Yes. Was the structure entered a dwelling? Yes. We, the jury, as to count three of the indictment, find as follows. The defendant is not guilty. So say we all dated this 22nd day of October, 2020.